Malty. Hello, Malty. Marvellous Merry Malt Monsters. And thank you to Colby Whale. Yes, Colby, I did it this time. Thank you to Colby Whale for that malt mention. Malt mates, pull up a chair, pour a wee dram, chill out, relax. You're back in the Bothy, and this is Ralphy Review 840, where, because I forgot to credit my last malt mentioner, I have repeated for the first time, repeated a malt mention. Right. So I like to sort things out when they go slightly wrong. The occasional bloopers do happen, but one of the important things is not so much the problems that happen, because we all experience problems and omissions now and again, it's how we sort them out. And one of the little omissions that I was encountering recently was the fact that I haven't reviewed a very, very pungent, powerful phenolic single malt for a little while. This happens to be called Laphroaig. Now, I'm a big, big fan of extreme flavours. It's why I like absinthe. In fact, absinthe and Laphroaig kind of work together, as long as you don't put them in 50-50. But this is a whiskey that I've not seen for a while. And it's re-emerged on the market where I am. And it's the cask strength version. 10-year-old, bottled at 60.1%. I have never seen a cask strength official bottling of Laphroaig as high as that before. And I can already, by the way, I'm surprised the glass can cope with this. It's coming out to meet me. And I'm going to be smelling this, tasting this, telling you all about it, and adding this to the other 16 Laphroaig reviews that I've done over the years here on ralfy.com. The last time I reviewed the cask strength 10-year-old was, as far as I'm aware, sometimes I get these wrong, but I'm just going to go with it anyway, Ralphy review number 30, which was a way, way back in the mists of time when the quality of my videos was nowhere near as good as they are now, in terms of appearance and lighting. But it was in March 2009. So it was right back at the beginning. So I feel like I'm returning to meet a rather bad-tempered and very colourful old friend here. I must warn you before we start that Laphroaig is not for the faint-hearted. It's a bit like a ralfy.com review. It's Marmite. You're either going to love them or hate them. And it's like, that's what it's like with Laphroaig. Once you taste it, you will hate it or you will love it. However, it's worth noting that whisky fans who have really gone into the malt journey and been tasting a lot of whiskies over a space of 5 to 10 years will come back to Laphroaig. And there's a reason for that. It's because over time our palates adjust. The shock of the new is no longer a shock because it's no longer new. And people sort of wean themselves into a greater appreciation of these heavy, heavy phenolic whiskies over time. And particularly cask strength, you just get a little bit, you don't get a little bit, you get an awful lot of added extra. So, nose. Very fragrant, earthy. You could say savoury, but savoury doesn't really cover the degree or range of savoury notes in here, because you've got this savoury sensation with the flavours of earth, of chimney soot, of damp fires, of barbecues, definitely, and of burning seaweed, you know, real hot burning seaweed. I mentioned jokingly when I was in my last review, 839 extras, when I was intimating this review, that it was rather, you know, if the Empire's Star Wars Death Star suddenly morphed into something else, if it happened to morph into a bottle of single malt whiskey, this is what it would be, because it's that distinctive and singular. volcanic. Yeah. These sort of adjectives and references that I've used in the past. Enormous volcanic eruption. Sulfurous pits and all the rest of it. They really do apply to Laphroaig. And if it's not for you, don't pretend to like it. And for many people who are much more comfortable with Glenfiddich and Craganmore and the Speyside whiskies, stick with that. If you happen to be blending your whiskies, be very, very, and I do recommend extreme caution in blending anything with Laphroaig, because whatever you do will taste of Laphroaig. It's the same as when you have a flight of whiskies. You never start with Laphroaig. It's always the finisher. Each and every time you finish with Laphroaig, because if you start or have Laphroaig before any other single malts, they will all taste of Laphroaig. Taste neat. Give me a minute. Ooh. Smoked fish. If you're in Scotland, there's a smoked fish called Arbroath Smokies. Very tasty. Make a delicious soup. Smoked fish bisque. And there is that aspect to Laphroaig. There is such, when you taste it neat, it is just an avalanche of intensity. You really can't pick out the individual flavours. Sure, it's phenolic, but it's the range of phenolics in there. They're all clumped together and they completely dominate everything about it. So I am going to add quite a bit of water, and for the simple reason, if you want to taste anything at all, you need to. Don't you listen to these people that say, oh, you never add water to whiskey, that's sacrilege, you're ruining your dram, blah blah, bullshit. Technically they don't know what they're talking about. It's just one of these jingoistic opinions that people pick up on and spout off after they've had a few drinks and are getting confident in their opinion. I've added 10 centilitres of water, 2 full teaspoons to that. And it'll take more. It will. It's now becoming a little more articulate, settling down. The super intensity is still intense, but less so. There's some bright phenolic notes, floral phenolic and aromatic herbal phenolics. Sage, which is a savoury herb, you're getting that. Iodine, absolutely loads of iodine. More iodine than a traditional band-aid sticking plaster. Ah, so much more articulate now in the palate. Burnt treacle. Bitter licorice. Intense fennel. Ash. Burnt wood. Pure peat reek. It's when you smell a peat fire, smell peat burning, you get that acrid, fusile peat note. You're getting it here. Ginger, baked apple, intense sultana, barley sugar, dry, very dry whiskey this. Arrival. Quite oily, peat note, develops gingery, herbal, herbaceous, bitter sour, very little sweetness in the development. And in the finish, you just have this this taste of smoked fish without the fishiness, but that intense smokiness along with the peat, very much intermeshed. See, it's like comparing it to Lagavulin is difficult because Lagavulin, although it's a peaty whiskey, is more smoky than peaty. And there's a more definitive separation in Lagavulin between the smoke and the peat. And I think that's primarily due to the shape of the stills. Stills in Laphroaig are different from Lagavulin. And it'd be fascinating, actually, to send up a lorry load of Laphroaig wash to be put through the Lagavulin stills and vice versa. Now, wouldn't that be an interesting project? It's something they could do if they were independent distilleries, and it would get a huge amount of endorsement and publicity, particularly when it was featured at Fisial. But being a corporate multinational, it's not going to happen. To Laphroaig's credit, very attractive distillery to visit when you're there. I highly recommend you get the distillery-only bottling. And what you're wanting is, when you arrive at the distillery, is to see, they've got a big massive pergola chimney right in the middle of the main building, and the peat smoke comes out the top. And such is the lie of the land and the coastal position of Laphroaig, and the fact that when you arrive at Laphroaig, you're elevated, you're looking down that hill, a short hill to the distillery. You get this waft of Isle of Peat smoke, and it's fascinating. They've got their own malting floor, you see. They've got their own kiln at Laphroaig, and it's a sight to behold. Got massive big double doors. It's like a great big Hansel and Gretel witch's oven. You know, you could push someone inside, they wouldn't last for long. But it's fascinating to see it, that process. And it's very encouraging that some of what they produce, they smoke the barley and they peat reek the barley themselves. Right, back to this malt before the malt mark. It's becoming more complex in the nose, much more accessible. It's one of these whiskies, unfortunately, that if you really like Laphroaig, there's not a lot out there that's any stronger than it, particularly cask strength Laphroaig. The only way you could get this stronger is 3-year-old Laphroaig out, you know, in refill bourbon casks, where basically you're getting tempered new make spirit, or claret as they call it. That's the only way you could get this more phenolic, or any whiskey more phenolic in terms of taste. But I'm thinking other whiskies that come anywhere near it, well, to a certain extent Lagavulin, but it's such a different whiskey that it wouldn't quite work, actually. I think young Laphroaigs from Tobermory Distillery, the really young ones you see from independent bottlers, at 5 or 6 years old, they're the ones that carry the real clout that could match Laphroaig, but there's no others. So if you're looking for a stronger version of a whiskey compared to Laphroaig, you're not going to find one yet. Anyway, final conclusions. There's a kind of vanilla note in the background there that, because everything's so swamped and blanketed in the phenolics, you can't really pick anything else out, and you don't get unpeated Laphroaigs out there, which would be fascinating for a comparison in this way you can do occasionally with Kulila. But the drop of water, it's an absolute epitome of a cold winter's day dram. You're taking a warm, glowing fireplace, and you're just lifting the whole fireplace out of the hearth and putting it into the whiskey, and getting a glass of fireside, winter, cold night comfort. And this is where Laphroaig is an absolute winner. A trivial aside, I'll leave that for the extras. 840 extras is coming along soon. in which I shall be continuing to discuss Laphroaig and my experiences with Laphroaig, things that I know about Laphroaig. In the meantime, a cask strength, I'm happy to give this 90 out of 100. Has it diminished any over the years? Well, I don't think so. I think that the producers are wise enough not to thin out Laphroaig because it would be a disaster. It just wouldn't work. It's a malt mark. That's what it is. And I have to say, you can more or less see it's a natural colour. But what's concerning me that is there's not quite as much scotch mist as I feel there should be. So I think there's chill filtration going on this, which is nothing short of a disaster. So really what you want to do is to really get a tangible point of reference into how much better this could be if they didn't chill filter it. You want an independent bottling of Laphroaig, and you find there's quite a few of them out there now and again. Fortunately, they don't get excessively priced like Lagavulin, for example, or Beaumont. But always keep your eye out for particularly young Laphroaigs from independent bottlers because they can be absolute blisteringly good, heavy Death Star types of single malt. Thank you for watching. As always, malt mates, it's a great way to spend a few minutes. I thoroughly enjoy myself and I hope you do too. Take your time, go canny, and I'll speak to you soon. In fact, very soon, if you care to watch 840 extras. I'm Ralphy. Bye-bye.